about speed? I seem to use that quite a bit as well.
I've learned something new.
Excellent. I don't know what it is, but concentration increase, maybe? We already had that. Event Horizon? No. I don't know what I learned. Very sorry. Yeah, I don't want to not recognize myself. Okay.
All right.
So you get to go. Bye bye. Bring back Calistige. What am I looking at? What am I doing?
This should be useful, my friend.
Yes, you do tend to be useful. Okay, so that maw goes to the trade post. That's the main quest, isn't it? Go to the trade post. So I guess we should go to the other one first. Look at that. So he's somewhere in the Nilnilius. We need to go back there. Find him. This goes to the anchorage. That's the little thing that we have to do soon. That goes to the anchorage as well. And that's the anchorage. So I guess we'll do all that first. Sure you're not going to sell to me? I'm a pretty cool person. Damn. Because I asked her questions or something, I don't even know.
Yes.
We're just trying to wrap all this stuff up before I finish for the day. For the duration. I get to sleep for free, which I should do soon so I can get rid of my fettle here. Demoralized.
Let's go.
Demoralize this. So where is this guy? I somehow missed him. It's possible. What's Calistia doing over there by herself? Now, he couldn't have gone through the maw. Downy's over there. Oh, here's... We didn't interact with that thing. Well, there's something here to find as well. What? I don't suppose this is him. I don't know how to get to him. Now, let's find this loot. There's some loot here. Gotta loot the loot.
Yes, now.
Cool, 32 shins. And concentrated spray flesh. I just have trouble saying that. We have quite a few. I have 5 and 3 here. Let's try to, like... Oh, it just went into this, yeah. Because he has 2. cool. We can heal those hit points, baby. Okay, so what is this thing? I never even went over here. Maybe he's like inside this thing. Or maybe that thing opens this thing. Maybe he's huddled inside there.
Go.
A construct lies motionless and partly disassembled here, spider-like legs splayed about it. A piece of knowledge clicks into place. This is, was, a creature known as an accelerator, a machine intelligence housed in a mechanical frame. Though they appear fearsome, the creatures are terrified of death and are always seeking new technology to incorporate into themselves in the hope of prolonging their lives. Inspect. You study the remains of the construct, putting the details together, noticing scattered piles of refuse and burnt holes in the back of its armor. The construct was likely cornered here and tried to flee up the mounds of trash rather than fight its tormentors. They attacked it from behind and it fell, either dead or dying. Perception check. You peer between the plates into the carcass's interior. Judging by the scratches, gouges, and broken components you see inside, someone purposefully jammed a blunt pole into the construct's innards in an attempt to crush its vital systems. Whether this happened before or after its death is unclear. That's not very nice. Then you notice something odd. Some of its wounds are partially repaired, as if someone has been visiting the dead construct and haphazardly patching over the burnt holes. Is this something Arving would do? The massive construct died, fleeing the beings that killed it. Countless small, charred wounds speckle its rear armor. Search for anything useful. You search for a few minutes, but find nothing of value. Scavengers must have long ago picked this construct clean. Absently, you lay your hand upon the metal shell to push yourself away from the wreck and feel a faint, intermittent vibration. Perception, quick fingers. Reach into the hulk and find the source of the vibration you felt. 100%. Gotta sleep soon anyway. Putting your shoulder up against one of the construct's vertical vents, you reach into the dark, probing carefully, following the vibrations rippling toward you. Straining, you walk your fingers up mesh-swaddled objects across a cable to a partially crushed cube strung with frayed wires. Machinery lore tells me that the cube is a construct's intelligence casing. It was catastrophically and perhaps deliberately damaged. The construct is well and truly dead. You carefully shift a loose hunk of metal from the cube's surface aside and keep looking for the source of that vibration. A wave of wordless sorrow crashes over you, tinged with flecks of hope. Your gaze shifts back to your hand and the hunk of metal. The alien emotion came through it into you. As if summoned by the thought, a small floating sphere drifts into view. It prods at the cube with a beam of light, then vibrates softly. Huh. Watch the sphere at work. The sphere drifts around the inside of the dent, construct, occasionally halting to, yes, it's repairing damage, as if patching holes in the armor will bring its host back to life. Every few moments, it returns to the broken cube and attempts to repair it again. When nothing happens, the sphere vibrates, and when that happens, you hear a soft series of whirring clicks. Whirr, click. Machinery, lore. You listen to the soft clicking for a long while until you realize you are making the sounds yourself, beneath your breath, speaking words of grief in a machine's tongue. I'm sorry, I forgot. Come back. Come back. It continues its circuit of the dead construct, trying to bring it back to life with minor repairs. Every time it fails, it breathes a series of soft, whispery clicks. Take the sphere and the module. Chirurgeon sphere. You pull the communication module from the surface of the cube, and the sphere follows, shivering in the open air. It turns as if taking in the ruined hulk one last time, then it settles into your open palm obediently, shuddering. A chirurgeon sphere. This is a bonded item artifact. confers Chirurgeon's Sphere. Heals 2 to 6 points of health per turn. Nice. Active 5 rounds. Negative effects minus 15% on might tasks. This little spherical flying automaton is a faithful companion to whoever bears a small module used for maintaining telepathic connection with the automaton. If the bearer is damaged, the automaton is activated and tries to repair the damage. Sweet. The automaton's mind has a tendency to wander, and it takes some mental acuity to maintain its focus through the telepathic connection. Though it seems like an ideal companion, the automaton has not historically provided long life for its owners. Tales tell of a rough-hewn and simple glaive who took a very direct approach to any problems she faced, depending on the Chirurgeon's Sphere to recover her wounds as she flung herself into battle. Unfortunately, one day the sphere found more interest in a passing butterfly than her fight with a deadly Calorale. So what do I have now? I have this thing. Might Edge. Immunity to dazed and blinded. I'm gonna take this off. Chirurgeon Sphere. Sweet. Oh. The partially disassembled construct lies here, utterly motionless and silent. Now that you've taken the spherical drone from inside of it, there's little else to do here. Where's this guy? Tybir.
Yes, lass?
I'll remember that.
Somewhere in this place, he says, staring around little Nylash with a hint of desperation. Visibly steeling himself, he touches the ring with his opposing hand. Old pain, he gasps. Digging in stinking trash. Hunger. He jerks his hand away as though burned. Something is wrong. He feels different. Somewhere in this place, digging through trash. I'm with you. I don't suppose it's this guy, old guy over there. Can't be this crimper guy. And he digs through trash. He's different. Was he changed by the maw? By one of the maws? There's no one named that around here. He's going by a different name. Because he's different now.
Ready.
I am the very soul of action.
Glad to see you, child. Always a pleasure. May the heaps yield their best treasures to you. Have you seen a ring like my friend is wearing? Okay. Blinking, mouth working silently, Tybir prefers his hand, clearly at a loss. Yeah, yeah, Crimper says, glancing at Tybir's ring. He rummages within his filthy rags. I have one just like it. He holds it up, pinched between two claws. It's absolutely identical. A tall man dropped it in a pile of butcher's leavings a few weeks back. He chuckles, eclipsing Tybir's pained sigh. Brushes hands off like he handled something awful. The filthy man mimes the motion, rubbing his hands fretfully on his greasy clothing, then cackles. That's it, Tybir says heavily. He got tired of looking for me and dumped the ring with our friend here. He offers you an unconvincing grin. Spare this way. I'm glad he's clear of this place. Glad he's gone.
I'll remember that.
Gone? Crimper says, puzzled. He's not gone. I saw him this morning, waiting his turn at the Shrine of Great Chilla. The old man looks between the two of you pointedly, clutching his treasures close to his narrow chest. Maybe he's still there. Let's go find him, Tybir. All right, Tybir says, massaging his hand. Whenever you're ready, lass. Doesn't matter if he spits in my face and storms off. At least I'll know I tried. He glances over at Arving's lost ring, and the old man tucks it protectively back into his rags with a suspicious scowl. Tybir's mouth quirks, but he leaves the scavenger to his treasure. I'd do quick fingers and steal the ring. Ah, yeah, a farewell to you too. Alright.
Yes.
Tracking this guy all over the place. To the Shrine of Great Chilla, then. Which is not far.
Yes, now.
I guess he's inside there? No. Hold on. I don't suppose he just walks without fear. Huh.
I'm ready.
Too bad they won't let you sleep for free. Where's Orving?
Updated my journal.
Jagged antlers twist from this blue-skinned mutant's temples. Permanent creases shape his face, revealing a history of scowls and grimaces. His glance slices past you to Tybir, and then to the ring on Tybir's hand. He tenses. He thinks, skist. It matches the one from that tall boy. I had a feeling you were coming for me sooner or later, he says, lips twisting. I never should have put that ring on. His twisted hand creeps toward a crude dagger on his belt. Bullying a little girl wasn't enough for you, yeah? You want to finish the work your friend started? Tybir looks at his hand, then to you, confused. You turn your attention back to the mutant. You aren't Orving. That his name? No, I ain't. He drops his hand back to his side. I'm a thief, and I ain't nothing like what people would call a nice man, but I ain't no Orving, either. He spits on the ground. It's like this. Kelsey has these headaches, like I did at her age. The only thing that helped her sleep was that singing wall. He looks between your blank faces and his brow furrows. There was something buried in it. Sounded like voices humming together. His expression darkens. And a few weeks back, your man came in, put her to the side, knocked a hole in the wall, and took the thing out. He scowls. She begged him to leave it, and he ignored her, and took her singing wall away. He thinks she still cries herself to sleep when she gets to sleep at all. Poor girl. No, Tybir snarls, turning on the mutant. You're lying. Orving wouldn't do that. Tybir speak. He's a good man, Tybir continues, baring his teeth. Better than this world deserves. So you're going to tell me the truth, and tell me now. I ain't lying. After I came home and found Kelsey weeping, I went after your man, caught him alone, and maybe saw my daughter and me, because he told me he was sorry, and that he took her music away because he was doing dirty work to help a friend. He eyes Tybir. Not that that excuses anything, but he might have been telling the truth. After I put the ring on, I heard laughing. That's why I dropped it. I couldn't stand the feel of that voice in my head. And he... what? Gave you the ring as compensation? Tybir says, hands balled into fists. The mutant blinks. No. I took it off his hand before I dumped the body, he says. I'm not gonna stop him. Snarling, Tybir pushes past you. You killed him, he screams, murder in his eyes. You worthless sack of meat. No, Tybir. The Arving you told me about wouldn't want you to hurt him. Tybir's opinion improved. Tybir falters and casts a hateful look at you. Yet his opinion improved. You're right, he says. Tears spill down his cheeks. Damn you. He turns from the mutant, who flees immediately. I want to have words with Dracogen, and soon. He thinks it was Dracogen laughing. The bastard knew. Oh, boy.
Yes, lass?
About Orving. Not now, he says, his smile fading. Not until we talk to Dracogen. Sure you don't want to talk about Orving? Let's have words with Dracogen first. Hey, hold not. Oh, I'm well enough. Tybir breathes a ragged sigh. You've been kind to me, and, well, that's hard. It reminds me of old times. He stretches. That's a different one. Okay, back to Dracogen.
Ready.
Guess we haven't achieved Dracogen's quest yet. Which lie at the trading post. We'll go talk to him.
On it.
On it. Hey, let's sleep.
All right.
He agrees. So close to Dracogen, too. We'll get rid of this fennel. Yay.
We approve.
I'm sure you do. Are you still interested in exploring the bloom, my friend? Word has reached these little humble ears of a new maw opening near the court of Gargoto in Little Nylish. If it leads to the place I recall, which I thought long gone, it may contain devices of great value indeed. If I did not have pressing business here, I should explore it myself. But I forget myself. What can I help you with today? Let's see what it says. Gristler tells me the trade post is gone. Devoured. His voice sharpens, and his gaze is intense. You have agreed to my terms. Do you now tell me you cannot fulfill your end of the bargain? I think not. You are resourceful. He frowns. I doubt the trade post is truly gone. You simply need to find another maw that will take you there. He thinks, is this castoff weaker than her kind, or is she simply toying with me? Oh yeah, he's gonna have opinions about these people. I'd like to talk about some of the people of the Bloom. I do not frequently indulge in gossip, but I see no harm in answering your questions. Oh, the people in this chamber again? Tell me again? Oh, okay. I thought it was gonna be someone new that we had encountered after we talked to him. Tybir, you said you had something to discuss with Jacogen? I want to talk about what you did to Arving, you worthless piece of... What I did? Tybir. Really? Jacogen looks to you. Did Tybir not tell you how he and I came to be acquainted? Then let me. He crosses his arms. Tybir was a mercenary, for sale to the highest bidder. He came to the Bloom to serve as a lackey to whoever would pay him the most, in coin, drink, or flesh. An employer approached him about retrieving an artifact from a guarded vault. He took the job. Let him continue. Blue, right? Yeah. Your gallant friend helped pacify the guards, and he watched as his compatriots slaughtered the helpless men. It was then that revealed the vault was mine. Wisely, Tybir quit the job and threw himself on my mercy, naming all his conspirators. I took justice on them and gave their children a lifetime of nightmares. But from Tybir, I asked only a year of his service, or his mind link ring and a favor to be named. He gave me the ring and fled. I did not pursue him. I am a man of my word. When his lover came, seeking answers about the ring, he found me instead. Orving agreed to serve in my employ for a year in exchange for the truth of Tybir's whereabouts. I made him my toy. He did work that Tybir would shrink at, in some of the darkest, most dangerous depths of the Bloom. And in all this time, Tybir never returned. Tybir knew what he sacrificed when he gave me the ring. He knew that Orving would come, but he gave up the ring without a second thought. At any time, he might have come to me to request its return. He never did. In so doing, he knowingly condemned his lover to his fate in the Bloom. Tybir swallows hard, shaking his head, not in negation, but in shock. He does not interrupt. He thinks, I didn't know he would come. I didn't. Not for certain. As for you, Tybir, the favor to be named later is this. I want you to recall the many ways you could have saved Orving. To think of how he might have died. To reflect on the depths of his devotion to you, and shallowness of yours to him. This is the kind of man you travel with, Castoff. Know his true character. Best of luck to both of you. He waves his hand, dismissing you. He thinks, an easy favor, perhaps, but the boy Orving more than compensated. Now go.
I ruined him. I'm the one killed Alvi. Not that fool at the shrine.
Tears streaked down his cheeks, unheeded. Here's the truth about what separated us. I was afraid to lose him, so I broke his heart. Cheated on him, and used my ring to make sure he knew. And it didn't work. He still loved me, and he didn't understand why I was pushing him away. So I waited until he was away on a supply run, and turned our mercenaries on the village Avi had sworn to protect. He chuckles through his tears. That did it. One look at the soldiers shoving children into the streets, and Avi bashed me in the jaw and said we were done. He covers his face with his hands. You were afraid to lose him, so you pushed him away? I loved him, he said, gripping his head with bloodless fingers. More than I love myself. I'd felt him die dozens of times in the endless battle. I wanted him out of my head, understand? I wanted him gone, so that when death took him for the last time, I wouldn't feel it. His sigh is a soft, ragged thing. Still, I wish I'd run after him like I wanted, but I was scared, and I ran to the Bloom instead. And then, I gave it the ring to save myself from Jacogen's revenge. He continues, his hands shaking. Of course I did, and I convinced myself Avi wouldn't suffer because of it. But he did, he says, clawing the tears from his eyes. I knew he was here. And I was afraid to face him. And look what my beautiful, honest lad came to in my absence, trying to save me. I made him like me. He thinks, I'm sick of the lies. It's my fault, and that's the plain truth. You aren't responsible for Arving's decisions. Huh. Red tide small amount and gold tide tiny amount. Maybe not. He says, blotting his cheeks on his arm. But he's dead anyway, and I had a part in that, like or not. He straightens, adjusting his clothing, and gives you a weary smile. Sometimes you feel like a day should end when you've borne too much, but it doesn't, and you have to keep going, don't you? He takes a deep breath. Give me some time to myself, will you? I've had enough of talk for now, being honest. Well, he can level up.
Yeah.
We can increase speed for that sucker punch that I always use. Oh, 1 point remaining. About one speed, one might. Gold blue still. Just checking. Castige. Edge is the last thing. What does she have edge in now? Speed and intellect. Increase intellect. So we have concentration increase, plus one training level, and enhanced esoteries. While phased, Calistrius' esoteries can be cast one step further in range than normal, and any fettles applied by them last plus two rounds. Calistrius is stronger with her sisters behind her than she ever was alone. While flickering between realities, her attacks reach further than they normally would and are much more effective. Sweet. We can choose two out of these. Datasphere Link, plus one training levels in Lore Machinery, Lore Mystical, and Lore Natural. The knowledge of the ancients is at your fingertips. With a little concentration, you can summon esoteric lore and random trivia. Plague Spirits. Cool. Infuse critical hits with entropic forces conferring disrupted on top of the normal effects of the ability. Entropic forces destabilize the target, causing negative effects to increase each round. When you strike true, your enemies quail. The damage you do lasts beyond the moment, devouring your foe's energies from the inside. The only thing it's only effective on in a, a critical hit. Maelstrom. Cool. Two of the following damages: energy, chemical, mental, transdimensional, and relativistic. And physical. For a total of 12 damage, even on miss, you deal 1 damage per level of effort applied. To a max of plus 4. Defended by willpower, you unleash a many-faceted assault upon all enemies before you, using every secret in your expensive repertoire. I'm going to choose these two, because I don't really have... The lore isn't going to be that valuable for her, because I'm using it. Castoff's using it. So that's that. Anything new to say? Tybir probably doesn't want to talk.
Yes, lass.
Talk about Oving? I prefer not to, lass, Tybir says. It's all too fresh. Maybe another time. Not now. Not yet. Absolutely. No problem. Alright. Look at that. So at the main, the trade post, this is to Lost Anchorage, and the Infestation.
In an instant.
You're gonna love it in an instant.
All right.
Remind me to tell you the tale of the courtyard of many returns. Something. Okay. So stay tuned for the next episode when we go through one of those two mods. Until then, thanks so much for watching. See you in the next one, and endure. And enduring, grow strong.